what an amazing Guitar Heroes show that was. And it was a real special occasion for everybody on stage. And I really want to just maybe start the conversation by asking David his thoughts on everybody seemed to be smiling on stage last night. Did you have a good time?
Well, I had more. I really had a good time, but it was also a life experience for me. I've been watching James Burton since I was about 11. That's not an exaggeration, when he was on the Ricky Nelson show. And he's been a huge influence and a hero of mine. When I started learning the electric guitar, he was maybe the guy I copied the most. And so that was a thrill, and it's always a joy to play with Amos. We've done it before. We've been in a band together, and Albert's fantastic. I think that's the fastest I've ever played in my life, so or tried to.
Country boy.
And
fastest I didn't play in my life. He hit country boy, and I just quit. I think that's off the metronome.
I played half fast, as they say, on that one. But yeah, so it was a fantastic experience. Thanks. Yeah.
What about you, Amos? Some comments about last night?
Well, like David said, I'm a little older than Dave. I'm only 2 years younger than James Burton, but yeah, he was one of two or three guitar players, I guess, James Burton and Chuck Berry, early on. And when I first picked up a guitar, I was 14. I asked James a couple of questions last night. When I was 14, James was 16, and that year he wrote as well as played on a huge hit for Dale Hawkins called Susie Q, which we played last night. I think it was the second song
Something like that.
And I was just picking up a guitar and starting to learn to fret my first chord, and he was a monster and only 16 years old. So I figured he must have started playing when he was 3 or 4. So I asked him, I said, how old were you when you started playing? He said, 13. And I went, Jesus Christ. And by the end of his first year, he was the house guitar player on the Louisiana Hayride, which will probably rival the Grand Ole Opry as the biggest nationally broadcast music show in country music at the time. And I just said, man, that is prodigious. It was just a thrill to hang out with the guy as well as play music with him.
Well, David and Amos have worked together on many locations, many projects, many different situations over the years, and that all started in Toronto. I'm just curious about, it would have been probably the Yonge Street scene in Toronto where when the two of you were kind of getting involved in playing guitar, that's where the action was. Would that be the case, David?
Not for me so much, because I was a Yorkville purist.
Me too.
The acoustic scene, and I was a snob, and I thought it took no talent to play the electric guitar. Boy, was I wrong. But I was a pure acoustic player, and I played in Yorkville, and that's the first time I saw Amos was on open mic night at the Riverboat, and you were in the Dirty Shames, had been for a while, and you played 9-pound hammer, I remember, and all the guitar buffs watched and went, ooh, it was, had a reputation even then.
I don't remember playing 9-pound hammer, but I don't remember a lot of things. I was sort of a mix. I wasn't strictly an acoustic purist, but because I started playing, the first guitar I ever played after about 6 months on an acoustic guitar as a 14-year-old, I started borrowing an electric guitar and learning to play rock and roll and stuff. And then I discovered the roots of rock and roll later on, like when I was in college, about 18, I started hearing, I guess, first commercial folk groups like the Kingston Trio and something. But you would read the album notes of groups like that, or the Limelighters and the Brothers Four, and they would lead you back to Pete Seeger, and he would lead you to Lead Belly, and he'd lead you to Blind Lemon Jefferson and stuff. All of a sudden, I started getting into acoustic music, more blues than anything else. But I still had that electric urge in my body, and I think I was one of the first Yorkville guys that started exploring the Yonge Street scene. And I went down there, and I walked in and heard Ronnie Hawkins when he had the band that later became known as The Band, playing in the Cock Door, and it was a mind warping experience. They were such a great bar band, rhythm and blues band. And then I started prowling the street, and I discovered David Clayton Thomas and the Shays with Freddie Keeler. That
Freddie
was
Keeler,
right.
Yeah.
Left-handed monster Telecaster player. And then Diane Brooks and the Silhouettes playing upstairs in the. They didn't have a liquor license. I can't remember the name of the place. It was a little bit north up there with a tremendous band. Steve Kennedy, great tenor player, and I sat in with the Hawks after they left Ronnie on numerous occasions at their jam sessions. So I was re-entering the world of the electric guitar then.
Well, correct me if I'm wrong. A little piece of music trivia. I believe it was Amos, you that brought John Hammond to see Ronnie Hawkins and the Hawks.
Almost. Okay. I will correct you because you're almost right. I was going to take John. I'd become friends with John because he was playing. You know, he was a great acoustic blues player, and he was playing the coffee house scene in Toronto. And he asked me one day, he said, "Are there any good electric blues bands in Toronto?" And I said, "Oh yeah, there's some really good ones, and better than I think some of the new bands coming out of Chicago, for instance." And I really think that the very first Butterfield band was not his best band by a long shot, and that I think Levon and those Young Street bands were better blues bands, they were better players, with the exception of Mike Bloomfield and Paul. I thought the rhythm section was so-so. But anyhow, I said, "Yeah, John, I'll take you down. These guys play these Saturday matinees, and they're sort of like jam sessions. You might be able to sit in with them." And then I came down with a flu a couple of days before that, and I arranged for someone else to pick John up at a hotel and take him down and meet the guys. And you know what happened after that?
Yeah, I could just. Briefly say that what happened was John Hammond went to see the Hawks, fell in love with the band, was recording for Vanguard Records back then, and invited the band to come down to New York. They may have been there anyway, but he invited them to play on his record on Vanguard. And subsequently, that's their first recording session outside of Canada, and that led to them kind of going on their own and signing with Albert Grossman and becoming the band. And that's kind of like it started in Toronto with a connection to Amos.
Kind of.
Yeah. David.
Yes.
Lonnie Johnson was on the Young Street, not the Young Street, the Yorkville scene back then. And
he was.
Of course, a guitar hero of legendary proportion.
Mm-hmm.
Did you go see Lonnie Johnson when he was there?
I saw him a couple of times. There was a place on that was called, believe it or not, Howard's Campus Kibitzeria. I didn't name it. And they used to bring in blues singers from the South. They brought in Booker White, Jesse Fuller, who else? Roosevelt Sykes. Lonnie Johnson was there. He played there. I remember him sitting in, I think, with Sunnyland Slim. And so I saw him there, and I saw him a couple of other times, too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So it was quite an environment for acoustic blues artists and Delta blues artists back then who were rediscovered to be coming to Toronto?
Well, it was opening up, and of course there was a core crowd that were really fanatical and would follow them around and ask them questions and stuff like that. And I had an interesting experience because I had a buddy who had a book that listed all the hits of the various singers. And one way we tried to get close to them would be to find out their hits and request them. And so we were young guys and teenagers or whatever. And I remember Roosevelt Sykes had two hits. Great, great boogie piano player, blues piano player. Had two hits in the book, 44 Blues and Dirty Mother for You. Okay, so my friend took 44 Blues and went up to Mr. Sykes and said, "Could you please play 44 Blues?" And Mr. Sykes said, "Sure, son," and went and played it. And I said, "Could you please play Dirty Mother for You?" Which I found out later can also be pronounced Dirty Mother for You. But I didn't know that then. So I went to Mr. Sykes and I said, "Could you please play Dirty Mother for You?" Wall of ice comes down. And he says, he leans in close to me and says, I'll play it a little later when the place clears out a bit. Okay, he sang the funniest, dirtiest song, and he would play the bass with a left hand and point me out in the crowd. It's a hot dog, baby, and it's never cold. It's just right for to fit your role. And I'm 17. I'm turning 80 Ooh. Shades of red. It was an interesting part of my education.
Amos, I would imagine that's where you first ran into the Quesken Jug Band was on that scene. Is that right?
I can't remember the order. I think I heard the band in its entirety first at the Riverboat.
Uh-huh.
And went and listened to them as much as I could. I was getting right into jug bands and researching, you know, Gus Cannon and the Louisville Jug Stompers and this stuff. And here's a, you know, a really, really good young jug band from Boston, of all places, you know. And then Maria got pregnant, and the band had to take a leave of the whole band had to go on maternity leave, and Jim came back, you know, on maternity leave. Jim Quesken came back to the Riverboat solo, and I went down and introduced myself, and he asked me to get up and play. And I think one time, that first time the jug band came through. They stayed at my parents' house one night. They had a night off and no hotel, and I'd sort of befriended them, and they had a gig the next day up in Aurelia or some place like that, and it was winter and awful. My mother made an incredible meal with wild game and stuff, and that, and they all loved that, except Quesken, who was a vegetarian. But she made something special for him, too.
And Amos mentioned Maria. That's Maria Muldaur, formerly Maria Dalmato, with the Jim Quesken Jug Band.
Maria Rose Grazia D'Amore D'Amato.
And Jeff Muldaur, who yep. you had such a long career with as well,
yes.
playing with Jeff and Maria together. And that kind of takes you to Woodstock, and later David to Woodstock.
But yeah.
Could you fill us in on that time, how you ended up, I guess you weren't with the jug band, of course, but you did have an invitation to join Jeff and Maria Muldaur, right?
Yeah, when the jug band broke up, Jeff and Maria moved to Woodstock. They were with Warner Brothers. The jug band was with Warner Brothers Records at the time, and they gave Jeff and Maria a contract as a duet, and they decided to move to Woodstock. They were being managed by Albert Grossman, who was living there, and had just built a new recording studio, horrible studio, and but big and expensive, and I could never get a good guitar sound out of that place, and then I'd go somewhere. I'd go down to New York and do a session. I'd just plug a guitar in the amp, and they'd put a microphone in front of it, and I'd sound like a god, you know. I'd come, there's nothing wrong with our set. I said, you're using too much compression is your problem. And, oh, no, I'm not. And they fought you tooth and nail in that studio. But I digress, but I do that. And then I was playing with Ian and Sylvia Tyson at the time in the Great Speckled Bird. And Jeff and Maria invited me to come down to Boston first and make an album in a studio there, which was a really good album. I think it was called Pottery Pie.
Yeah.
And I had a great time, and I was really struck by not just their basic talents, but their versatility, how eclectic they were. And I was discovering, as my style started developing, that it sort of jumped genres nicely. It was weird. I could sit in with a blues band, and I sounded like a blues guitar player. I played the same stuff with a country band, and it fit in there. I even sat in with reggae bands and doing double string bends and stuff, and the guys, yeah, man, that's really nice. and with Ian and Sylvia Tyson, who were just giants and great, great talents, but they were writing in a very one-directional kind of prototypical country rock kind of mode. And it was wonderful music, but I wanted to get in an organization, a band that played sort of different forms of music, so I could expand my style. So, and they wanted me with a passion after that first album that we did in Boston. Jeff just loved my playing, and so he made up a rubber stamp. that said, "Leave Ian and Sylvia." And he started sending me stuff, old records and stuff. And he'd stamp all over the package, "Leave Ian and Sylvia, leave Ian and Sylvia." And finally I did, and that's what took me there.
Yeah.
That rubber stamp.
Well, Ian and Sylvia, there's another huge connection here because replacing Amos with Great Speckled Bird as a guitarist was David Wilcox.
Mm-hmm.
That's
and,
right.
I guess, you know, when Amos says versatility, I mean, that band and those two artists had such a deep background and appreciation of all kinds of traditional music and as, you know, country and English ballads. And
oh, yes.
So yeah. You fit in very well with that. And did you have to kind of pick up your game to do that, or was your background like that?
Well, I'm going to answer the question, but one brief interruption. You think you didn't get a good guitar sound at Bearsville? Listen to Tennessee Blues by Bobby Charles.
Yeah.
It's beautiful playing, you know, yeah. By Amos at Bearsville. It's
yeah, there were moments. There was some stuff I could do, especially yeah. if I played on my front pickup, my rhythm pickup, and if I could talk the engineer into not using any compression whatsoever so I could have some dynamic range, which is something I do pretty well, I think. And I had moments at Bearsville, but if I tried to do anything other than that, you know, or if I played at any kind of volume, if I wanted a little crunch with playing with Butterfield, a blues thing, they'd just squash me with compression and piss me off.
All right. So, yes, joining Ian and Sylvia. They had a very successful band at that time, and Amos had an enormous reputation, and I heard that Amos was leaving the Great Speckled Bird. Ian also had a television show with Anne Murray, and the band was the house band, and I was somewhat envious because, you know, Amos was getting to play with these people. Well, I had bought a Telecaster on a pawn ticket on a whim, and I was working at times with Leon Redbone then as a duo, and once or twice, and Leon tried my Telecaster, which I wish I had a photograph of him playing an electric guitar. But anyway, I heard, and I thought there's no way I could get the gig, but I begged Ian's phone number from somebody and phoned him and pleaded for an audition. He gave it to me, to his everlasting credit, and that was really the start of my career as a professional musician, full-time professional. Yeah, but enormous shoes to fill, because Amos was not only a great player, and is a great player, but he was very popular socially, and he had very adept in a natural way, and I'm not as much. And I'd go to different cities, and Amos's buddies and friends and crowd would show up, and, oh, no Amos. And there'd be this silence and kind of a thud. And so they were large shoes to fill. I really had to struggle to, you know, to learn, but yeah. I kept the job.
What were some of the highlights of people you played with on the TV show? Because they brought in so many different people, didn't they?
Oh, well, Charlie Rich, Anne Murray, I got to play with her, who's a fine singer and was very, very nice to me. Carl Perkins, Bobby Bear, a lot of the country stars of that era.
Yeah, you know? I played with Bobby Bear in that show. He must have come up more than once.
He did, yeah.
He taught me the hook guitar lick to Detroit City, which I played differently. I did it with a tuning peg.
Oh, yeah?
And he did it by pressing down on the sixth string behind the nut, which was okay, but I did it just by turning the peg. Hmm. And I remember that about him. And Stompin' Tom Connors, actually, Ian and I sort of discovered Stompin' Tom. I think it was actually Alan McRae. You remember Alan
Folk
Gordon?
Folk singer.
Yes. Alan McRae. Oh, what was his?
And yeah, Man of the World.
Well, that was his real name, but he wanted to be, he had a fairly thick Scottish accent. He wanted to be a country western singer, and he thought Alan McRae sounded too Scottish, so he changed his name to Alan Gordon. Anyway, Alan called us up and said, "That's a sweet little weird guy playing down at the Horseshoe Tavern. He's a little short, stubby guy. He's got great big cowboy boots, and he puts a wooden plank on the floor, a piece of plywood. And when he's playing, it kicks his foot. And all he sings songs about potatoes." And it's from Prince Edward Island. And his name's Stompin' Tom. You got to see him. He'd make a good guest for your television show. So we went down and we saw him, and Ian and I just, our jaws dropped. Watching this guy who became a Canadian, you know, icon in time, and Ian had him on the show, and the show was done at what was the name of the station? CTV.
Yeah, CTV. I can't remember the.
Whatever. John Bassett.
CFTO.
Yeah.
CFTO.
Which was kind of out in Don Mills, and we got Stomp and Tom on the show, and we were taping the show, started in the morning. And then we broke for lunch, and the whole crew and the cast always we would have lunch in the cafeteria, and the food was horrible institution food, and we all knew that the mashed potatoes that they served were made with powdered potatoes, and no one said anything, and there was sort of utter silence, and we got our burnt roast beef, and mushy peas, and our soupy powdered mashed potatoes. Stuff, and we all went back and sat down, and everyone was sort of looking at Stomping Tom. silence. And then he had his first mouthful, and he looked up and he went, "These aren't real potatoes, are they?" And the whole place went, "Ah!" Everyone fell off their chairs. That was my biggest Stomping Tom moment. These aren't real potatoes, eh?
I'd like to find out a little more about the Woodstock scene that the two of you were part of. You lived in Woodstock. I think you said this, but what brought you to Woodstock, David?
Some guys who I'd played with in Ian and Sylvia's band started a group down there, and I had left Ian and Sylvia because I needed to experiment more on the guitar, and I was really starting to like the electric guitar, and I wanted to play longer solos and that sort of thing, just get into something where I had a lot of creative input, you know. So I had quit the band, and these guys phoned me up, and they were starting a little group down there, so I went down and joined a band in Woodstock and jammed around the scene a bit. I jammed with, I think, Maria, and Amos was there, of course, already well established, and so that was the story of that, really.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You didn't stay that long then?
I stayed for, I think, a year and a half. Uh-huh. And I was very poor, and the band I was in, I think, was a pretty good band. If they had the right producer, they might have done something, but it didn't, and so I eventually left town. Yeah.
Yeah. What was the band, by the way?
It was called Juke.
And right.
It was
okay.
A good little band. I think the seed was planted for my eventually joining Maria's band with you.
Yeah, indeed. Well, I was getting to hear David play electric for the first time. I thought, geez, this guy's getting really, really good. And when I joined Maria's band, it was about a year after the Midnight Eight. The first album, which contained Midnight at the Oasis, came out, and the hit hadn't really hit yet, and the band was kind of in transit. The drummer's time was a little wonky and weird, and Maria had some problems with the piano player playing kind of too stiffly, which I thought was silly because I loved his piano playing. But and then the guitar player was the great late Stephen Bruton, who became Chris Christopherson's guitar player for about 30 years or so, and died about a year ago, very far too young, cancer. And Stephen wasn't really happy with the direction that Maria's band was going in. I don't think he appreciated Jeff Gutchen being relieved of his duties. And so Stephen decided to leave. And Maria, right around then, Midnight hit. And all of a sudden, we were playing, you know, 2,000 to 4,000 seats off seaters for the most part, big venues. And Stephen had quit, and Maria asked me. I was sort of her right hand man, almost like her band leader for the time that I was with her. I always had to conduct the auditions and things like that. And she said, "Who would you recommend to fill Stephen Bruton's shoes?" And I said, "Well, I think I know the guy because." Maria was a very, like I said, and Jeff both, they were both very versatile players genre-wise. Her first album had a gospel song on it, it had country songs, it had some very unusual singer-songwriter very unique songs like Midnight at the Oasis. No one had written a North African love ballad since Sheik of Araby, I don't think, like that. And anyhow, she needed a versatile player and someone who knew, you know, acoustic styles and electric. And I said, I know the very guy. He's in Toronto, and his name's David Wilcox. And she said, well, let's get him. And that was how that happened.
Well, thank you.
I thank you.
Yeah. There's one wonderful Maria Muldaur album. It's called Sweet Harmony that has both Amos and David playing on it. Just wondering, David, your recollections, your memories of your time with Maria and that incredible band, because really for the time there were some great players in that band.
It was a really good band. The drummer Earl Palmer was fantastic. He played on everything from Tutti Frutti by Little Richard to the Huckleberry Hound theme to You've Lost That Love and Feeling by the Righteous Brothers, Frank Sinatra, Ella Fitzgerald. Anyway, just an amazing monster of a drummer. The Rolling Stone History of Rock and Roll says that if anybody could be credited with the invention of rock and roll, it's Earl Palmer. So, I mean, that's how important he was. And then playing with Amos, which is always a delight because we sound so different. There's no, we don't step on each other's toes, and we have very different approaches to the guitar, and I love hearing him play. And so that was just a terrific experience. Yeah, wonderful.
By the way, Earl
and
Palmer.
Ellen Carney.
Yeah?
Don't forget Ellen Carney.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Backup vocalist.
She's, and Mike Finnegan. Was Finn's in the band when you
were?
Yes,
he was. Yes.
Yeah. He's still around and doing great. You can find some of his stuff on YouTube. And I saw Earl Palmer taught me more about playing rhythm guitar than anyone I ever met. And who better to teach about rhythm guitar than a drummer? You know. And frankly, when I joined Maria's band, my rhythm playing was, well, it was a little regressive compared to my soloing ability had sort of gotten advanced beyond my rhythm playing. And Earl just basically wouldn't stand for it. He said, you know, Amos, you when you play in a rhythm section and stuff, if you're the principal soloist, you're still probably only soloing for 10% of the song. The rest of the time you're playing rhythm, and you have a responsibility towards the rhythm section to play good. So, okay, play this on this song. I want you to do this, and he'd show me a figure, and he was so helpful, and I saw him several times in the last 10 years, one at Maria's 60th birthday party. Earl was also partially responsible for getting me off the demon tobacco. Earl hated that stuff. He smoked when he was younger, but he quit. He had emphysema, and he'd phone me up in Turner Valley, Alberta, where I moved in 1989, and he'd say, are you still smoking? I'd say, well, yeah. He said, oh, damn it. Why the hell don't you quit? And I finally did. And then I saw Earl at Maria's 60th birthday party, and he's out the front deck smoking a cigarette.
Oh.
And I said, Earl, are you smoking again? He said, hell yes.
I think he lost a lung, didn't he?
Yeah.
David, I recall that Earl Palmer played on your first solo recordings, which were done for
CBC,
right?
Yes. Yeah. Well, that's never been publicly released. The CBC has it. And what happened was I got to record the first time for the CBC, and I wanted a really good drummer because I think a good drummer for any recording is absolutely essential. And so managed to arrange for Earl to come to Toronto and play on my little CBC recording, and I choked. Because I hadn't sung much on tape or to record. And Earl showed up, and he's nice and friendly and genial and stuff like that. And all of a sudden, when we started recording, all I could think of was Earl playing with Sam Cooke and Ella Fitzgerald and Frank Sinatra. And now I'm going to sing? I don't think so. Well, I sang anyway, but I learned that which does not kill us makes us stronger. You know? Yeah.
David's solo career went on to include 5 gold and platinum records and an introduction to so many fans of...
Thank you.
An introduction to blues, to various aspects of the blues. Hypnotized and Boogie turned so many people on to such a great groove. And, you know, that's a whole other side of David that we haven't even touched on. And I'm just curious about the... especially the boogie kind of grooves that you were listening to and how you developed that. Who were the guitar players that led you in that direction?
Well, Magic Sam from Chicago.
Yeah, I was going to say, saw him. My first guess.
I went to an incredible blues festival around 1968 or 69 in Ann Arbor, Michigan. And, I mean, today the lineup would be unbelievable. I think, most of the major names were there. One night, B.B. King headlined, then Muddy Waters and Howling Wolf, I think, were the other three nights. But they had tons of other great blues players. And Magic Sam, who died too young, played a song where he played by himself and then the band would come in. I think it was called Looking Good. And all night long, people were calling Jam. If somebody played well, they'd say Jam with Magic Sam, you know, because he had burnt the house down so badly.
Yeah.
And that was part of it, I guess. Yeah. So I was just like that sound, you know. Yeah.
Sure.
Earl Hooker, perhaps?
Yeah, well, very much so, yeah. When it comes to slide, Earl Hooker and Freddie Roulette were people who influenced me, Chicago players. I'm not sure if Freddie Roulette's a Chicago player. But I copied them with the slide, yeah. And, of course, Elmore.
James. Yeah, I played with Freddie Roulette, and I think he was a Bay Area guy, East Bay.
I think you're right, yeah.
There was a whole scene in the East Bay of San Francisco, Oakland, Berkeley, Richmond. I lived there for 15 years, and I got to play with Freddie. He played the Midnight at the Oasis solo on a lap guitar, and it was quite something. A little different than mine, but plausible.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Really something.
Yeah. Well, speaking of electric blues guitar playing, we kind of jumped over this, but Amos was a member of the Paul Butterfield Better Days band, which to my mind is one of the great blues bands of all time. The arrangements that band came up with for standard blues licks and that sort of thing, unparalleled, and two classic studio albums, one live album at San Francisco.
Yeah. Three albums, kind of counting the live album, but that we didn't even know was recorded. I don't know if you've heard this one, David, because it's not readily available.
Mm.
But a Japanese label just brought out a live at the Paul Butterfield Better Days Band Live at Winterland album. It cost about $68 on eBay. I think you can get it. We never even knew it had been recorded, but we did this concert at Winterland, which is about a 4,000 seat ballroom almost in San Francisco, when the band did its first promotional tour for the first Better Days album. And it was kind of a special event because the two opening acts were the Mike Bloomfield Band and the Elvin Bishop Band. So, and it was very competitive. And Paul, no one could out-compete Paul. Paul was like, Paul would not quit. If he couldn't get to an audience in concert, if he ever had a dud of an audience, he would finish the show by doing this harmonica extravaganza where he would start playing off mic, acoustically, no amp or anything, and way off from the mic and playing very quietly. And the band, we'd leave the stage, and then he'd play a little louder and he'd get closer to the mic, and then he'd play acoustically on the mic, and then he would pick up his little bullet hand microphone, which went through a guitar amplifier, and right when he hit that, we had filtered back on stage, and we would come in just all guns blazing, and then Paul would just play, and he would do a fast shuffle, and he would play until the audience was rabid, and then he'd leave the stage, and they'd want an encore, and he'd say, "Not tonight, you assholes," and leave the building. But that's how competitive Paul was, and that night in Winterland, on speculation, I don't know who did it. It was probably Albert, and Albert was there. It was a big event. There were movie stars there. Bobby Charles was there. Bobby Charles just joined the tour, and Albert gave him some money to come along on the tour and promote songs because Albert had gotten Bobby's publishing. And anyhow, trying to remember. Oh, yeah. Somebody, and I'm sure it was Albert, had gotten the Wally Hiders was the establishment recording studio in San Francisco. He'd gotten them to roll a remote truck up behind Winterland. We didn't even know that it was wired. And he recorded that show that night. And it is It's the best of the better days albums. We were way better live than we were in the studio, partially because of the studio we were recording in. But you know, I can't say anything bad enough about the Bearsville Sound Studio. I had a lot of fun there, I must admit.
Just curious, the 70s were almost a decadent time in the music industry. Jeff and Maria Muldaur were making very expensive records with all kinds of different arrangements, whatever you wanted. I mean, if you wanted an orchestra, yeah. Maria certainly had that, you know. A house maybe for signing a deal, or is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Just curious on some of the big studio sessions that you were part of, the most... she worked with big bands as well, didn't she? Holger Carmichael. There was some amazing recordings that you were at and played on.
Yeah, yeah. And I wasn't on all those sessions. I missed the Holger Carmichael session that was done. It didn't really need me. I mean, it was I think Benny Carter was her favorite sort of arranger and band leader for when she did big band stuff. Yeah. And I was rarely on that stuff. They'd have someone like Tommy Tedesco one of those real jazz guitar players.
Did you see much of that around Maria's sessions as well, and around kind of the lifestyle of being a recording artist and somebody with a hit in the 70s?
I definitely saw the decadence, and the album you were saying, Sweet Harmony, that we were on, you know, was basically just the group, and we went in and played songs we'd rehearsed for the most part, so it wasn't that extravagant, but I saw the extravagance and certainly the decadence too. A little bit of it,
We don't have a lot of time, but I do want to touch on a couple of things. I want to let you know that Amos has a jazz trio that's performing here this weekend, this afternoon.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, and kind of brings up another area of your expertise and your interest, and that's the huge jazz information that you have.
Yeah, well, I came out of... My family, my parents were huge fans of traditional jazz, and my mother lived in New York. That's where my father met her, although her family was originally from Albany. And after my dad got out of college, he moved to New York in 1930, and that was the beginning of a real heyday for traditional jazz and big band jazz in America, because for some reason New York became a magnet for all the regional areas like Kansas City and Chicago and New Orleans, and all jazz musicians from all the United States seemed to flood into New York about then. And my dad had three jobs. It was a depression, and he was a floor walker at Gimbel's, which is he had a degree in chemistry, and he was about halfway through his master's but the best job he could get was being a floor walker in a department store. And he said he was the only guy on the floor that didn't have at least a master's or a PhD. But he also played semi-professional basketball for the American Legion and also for the store. Had teams in two different municipal leagues. So he made about $75 a week, which is a huge amount of money for a bachelor to have at his, just, you know, in his wallet in 1930. So he just lived on 52nd Street, which is the mecca of jazz at the time. And as I was growing up, he introduced me to music through his record collection. And he also took me to the Colonial Tavern to matinees in Toronto. And a lot of these players, they remembered him because he was very distinctive looking. He was 6'7". He had snow white hair, and he had snow white hair when he was in his mid-20s, so he didn't look that much different. He was probably mid-40s about when he was taking me down to the Colonial Tavern. And we would go in and see a traditional... These guys were mostly Dixieland bands, Chicago-style bands, or New Orleans bands, and just about all the best guys in that field, with the exception of Louis Armstrong, who was just too big a star to play a little club like the Colonial. But we would walk in, and Dad would sit down at the table near the stage, and a band would get up on stage with like Muggsy Spanier, Jack Teagarden, Tony Ferrenti on clarinet, like that, and they'd be sort of noodling and adjusting their tuning thing on their trombone, and all of a sudden one of them would go, George Garrett, Jesus, and they'd all snap, and they'd all come over to the table. I was so impressed, because here are these giants, Wild Bill Davidson, Eddie Condon, and then they'd come over and say, George, where have you been? We haven't seen you in 20 years. Well, I moved to Canada, the 15 years ago or so, and I also was transferred out to Detroit for 10 years before that, so I haven't been in New York much. And then they'd sit down, and of course, my dad bought them a lot of drinks because my dad had a lot of money in the 1930s. They never forgot that either, I think. And that's sort of what started my interest in jazz. And I continued into learning and loving more contemporary jazz and bebop and stuff. And that kind of left my dad cold. He didn't believe in the flat five at all. Dizzy Gillespie was the devil. So, anyway, you come and hear my jazz show at 4 o'clock.
Yeah,
and you'll hear what I mean.
And check out the new CD. It's the Amos Garrett Jazz Trio, Jazz Blues, and that's the kind of theme of the band, combining that kind of music.
Yeah. It's really hard bop, but we shy away from that term because it scares people.
David, you've been very eclectic in your musical interests over the years, and I understand that you were a 78 collector as well.
I used to go down to the there was a Salvation Army thrift store downtown, and you could get 78s for 2 cents a record. So I'd go down, and the guy would give you a deal if he liked you. And so I'd get like 25 or 30 records. I got Milk Cow Blues Boogie by Elvis. I got Shimmy Shawabble, which was Gene Krupa's first record. All kinds of things in this among the 78s. All kinds of odd stuff, Yeah, it was great. Yeah.
Somebody else told me that you were also interested in opera in a serious way. Is it?
I'm fairly serious. I'm a big Caruso fan, and I like a lot. I was thinking recently that I like some of almost every style of music. Not all of it, but I can't name a style that I don't like something about. So yeah,
It's like Count Basie said, there's only two kinds of music, good and bad.
Right.
Yeah. And that's
which is very subjective.
David just said the same thing.
Yeah.
Well, here we are at the Island Music Fest. I'm just curious, what was the first folk festival that you were at, David?
Probably Mariposa in Ontario. Mm-hmm. And it was, well, I mean, such a diverse and interesting experience. And to hear it out, hear music played out in the woods, it's a beautiful thing. Hear it out
and
in the open.
Who was there?
Well, I mean, I remember meeting Howling Wolf, who he was a very imposing man, this great genius of the blues. And I was a very little, skinny little teenager. And I walked up to him, and he was standing backstage. And he was just looking like, he looked like a statue. And he turned to me, and we hadn't met or anything like that. And he said, I'm hungry. I'm real hungry. If I don't get me nothing to eat, I might have to eat me a few white people. And years later, I met him again. And I told him he said that. And he said, oh, that's just something you say, So Mariposa, a wonderful place to meet people and hear great music, as is this festival.
Yeah, my first folk festival was the first Mariposa, in fact. And Ian Tyson and Ian and Sylvia Tyson were second billing. Actually, the Travelers were top billing. And I accompanied a Scottish folk singer, Scottish Canadian folk singer named Alan Stewart. And that's about all my memories of that. But I also have a food story about folk festivals that I'd like to follow David's. I don't think I can top that one, eating white people. This story is true, and it emanates from this very festival. And it was told to me by Doug Cox, your artistic director. And one time, I think they're one of those, those gospel steel groups that come out of Florida, Sacred Steel. Mm-hmm. It's basically gospel vocal quartets, but they play instruments, and they almost always play a lap or a pedal steel guitar. It's very regional. comes up from the Miami area mostly. Well, there's a band here, I think, called the Lee Brothers. Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, the Lee Brothers are great guys, really sweethearts, and I've done workshops with them. But they're very imposing too if they first walk into a room, because they're all really big. They're all like almost, well, around 6 foot tall, and they're about 5 feet wide, and they dress like gangsta. They do wear gangsta clothes, you know, hoodies and the big basketball shoes, and they're matching blue satin. It says Lee Brothers on the back. And the food backstage at this festival is quite legendary. There's always some kind of wonderful snack being prepared for the performers and stuff. And one day, they made pork chops. And this guy made these great stuffed pork chops and cooked them over a wood fire with a covered barbecue, so it got kind of smoky, and put a sauce on them. And they were just incredible. Several years later, Doug was visiting a different festival somewhere. It was maybe Edmonton, I think. And the Lee Brothers were at the Edmonton Folk Festival. And they spotted Doug backstage, but they couldn't quite place him. And they came up to him and they said, "Oh, I don't know, you." He said, "Yeah." And Doug said, "Yeah, well, I'm Doug Cox. I'm the artistic director of the Vancouver Island Music Festival." And the Lee Brothers said, "Where's that? Where is that?" And said, "Well, it's on the West Coast, a big island off of the West Coast of Canada. And it's in a town called Comox." I said, "I can't quite remember. He says, "Well," he says, it's a beautiful, about 7,000, 8,000. You fly into Comox or Victoria and drive up." And finally, one of the Lee Brothers sort of remembered something. He said, "I remember that festival." I said, "Well, why? How, what do you remember about it?" He says, "That's the one with the pork chops." There you go. So that's what your festival is internationally known for, pork chops.
Well, I want to have you please thank these gentlemen on stage for being with us today, Amos Garrett
thank
and
you.
David Wilcox.
Thank you.